I made you guys wait a month for this. Oh my god, I'm a terrible person. Like that new intro? Here's the guy who made it. Link to his channel is in the description. Also, here's the guy who made my thumbnail. I realize I haven't plugged him either. Link is also in the description. There's also a link to part one in the description if you haven't seen that yet. And if you don't want to, don't worry. I'm gonna recap this entire list at the end of this video. Just skip to, this timestamp. One final link, a link to this list in playlist form, is also in the description for those who just really don't want commentary. They just want to hear the song. You know, that's fine. That's completely reasonable. All right, that's everything. Let's resume. Number 10. You know you're off to a great start when the first item on the list doesn't technically count, but you know what? Fuck you. A bunch of people are probably gonna try to argue that since this song originally peaked in late 1999, it's technically a song of the 90s, and if this song were just any other old number one hit, then yeah, maybe I'd be one of those people. But this song is just different. But you stay so cool. This is a millennial transitional song, the only one of its kind. It was the 19th biggest song in 1999, it was the second biggest song in 2000, it was one of the 50 biggest hits in the 90s, and one of the 50 biggest hits of the 2000s. It is the second biggest hit song of all time, and it is amazing. I don't throw around the term pop perfection lightly, except I definitely will be throughout the rest of this video, but yeah, I still love everything about this song. It's got an incredibly catchy, timeless melody, some surprisingly well-crafted lyrics, and some upbeat Latin-inspired production that somehow doesn't sound too dated even today. Santana's electric guitar solos are just sprinkled throughout here, and they're all great. And they finally found a vocal effect that made Rob Thomas's voice completely tolerable, thank God for that. If you leave, it'd be a crying shame. Santana made Rob Thomas's crooning oaf of a voice sound somewhat sexually charged. That's really something we gotta give him more credit for. Great beat, great atmosphere, great tone, great everything. It's the kind of song you just want to hear over and over and over, and thank God, because that's what happened. This song was inescapable. Everyone remembers it. I was a developing sperm cell when this came out, and even I remember it. Santana was immediately a legend after this. Whatever he released next was pretty much guaranteed to be a smash hit. Lord only knows what the man could do with so much power. So I guess it's too bad that his next song was monotonous garbage. Fun fact, this hit number one the week I was born. How unfortunate. And then there's all those songs you made with Chad Kroeger, like fucking, but let's forget about the worst vocalist of the century for now. What does the second worst vocalist of the century have to offer? I don't think this is too controversial a statement, so here it goes. Adam Levine is the worst vocalist currently working in pop music. I don't know why he sings like this. Only people with botched vocal cord surgery sing like this. Sometimes he even sounds non-human. This dude's voice single-handedly makes otherwise mediocre songs like Maps and Sugar completely insufferable. But Adam's voice honestly doesn't bother me at all here. It actually fits the song really well. This group finally found a style that matched his voice. That shit will turn into funk. Just like drown him out as much as possible. They even use a leading guitar that sounds almost exactly like Adam. And it's not just the instrumental, the lyrics also take advantage of Adam's whininess. This song is about the tedious aftermath of a miserable breakup. Feels so good to be back, not worth the aftermath, after that, try to get you back. Adam's not hiding it, he's the one that fucked up. He knows he fucked up. And his final course of action, in a very desperate attempt to retain some kind of dignity from what went down, is to try to convince himself that he never really cared about all this in the first place. And it's working, too. And it really makes me wonder. Be sure to relish this moment, because this is the only time I'm ever gonna say this sentence, but Adam Levine just sounds so cool here. He's angry as fuck. He has no reason to be. He knows he has no reason to be. But he is. All of this, of course, being summed up by the iconic This song is just so well put together. The synth is awesome, the melody is flawless, and the harmonizations in the chorus are incredible. Which, reminder, for Adam Levine is a fucking miracle. I can't believe people were pumping out genuine funk music in 2007. Honestly, this song's getting me kinda pumped up to listen to some Maroon 5. So what was their last single? You know, I'm actually picking up some of their original groove in this. You know, these guys might be on the right track.
Kidding me.
Number 8. Number 8 is Stronger by Kanye West. I don't know where to start with this one, mainly because I know absolutely nothing about Kanye West. I mean, I love the beat and how it reworked Harder, Better, Faster, Stronger from the ground up into this intense, gritty electro grind kind of thing. But that's about as deep as I can really go here, you know, can't squeeze 2 minutes out of that. So I figured, why bother pretending I know anything about rap music, like I usually do, when I have a whole community of Kanye fans right at my fingertips? Call this a cop-out if you want, because that's what it is. But today I have with me
Kevin, who reviews songs.
Hi, I'm Kevin. You knew that.
The LP Club, who reviews albums.
Hello from the other side.
Keenan, who makes music.
I am 12 years old.
And Bob, who just wanted to be here.
What's up, guys?
Well, great having you on here, dude. See ya.
Wait, what?
So, what do you guys think of Stronger by Kanye West?
I think Slow Jams is better.
You know, you can think that, but what about Stronger?
It's good.
One of my favorite Kanye songs.
Pretty banging.
Like, it might be just like the hardcore Daft Punk fan in me, but it's jamming. I love it.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I have a friend who hates music, but he just loves that song. Like, I mean, that's the transcending power
who
of Kanye.
Hates music? No.
But my friend.
Just like all music.
Yeah, he just doesn't like music.
Such a weird thing to hate. Yeah, Stronger. It's pretty. I don't know. If you saw my top 15 or top 10 Kanye songs, that wasn't on there. But it's still a really good song. I definitely like the sample a lot. I think the song runs on a bit too long. I would have trimmed the fat a bit. But it bumps. It's a pretty bumping track.
Definitely.
I love it.
So there you have it. My thoughts on Stronger by Kanye West. Take it or leave it.
The pimps in the crib, ma. Drop it like it's
number 7.
Drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot.
Hey, Double Agent, if Say It Right is your second favorite Timbaland song, then what's your first? Everything about this beat is amazing. The underlying escalating tone synth, the massive bass, the beatboxing, the laughing squirrel. Anyways, like I was saying, almost everything about this beat is amazing. It's a shining example of everything great about Timbaland. And probably some of the best of Justin as well. Now if I wrote you a love note. Justin's vocals on this song are some of his most vulnerable to date, on the verses at least. He's using probably his weakest falsetto, making him sound kinda nervous, yet somehow still incredibly suave. See, what's the point in waiting anymore? On their own, the lyrics are a little... This ring here represents my heart. Yeah. But when you contrast Justin's middle school infatuation over such an intense beat, it almost sounds Shakespearean, or at the very least, way less dorky than it reasonably should. And for what it's worth, by its own merits, Justin's performance on the chorus is pretty much perfect. You could really only expect such flawless harmonizations from Justin fucking Timberlake. Then there's T.I. who fucking kills it. In the good way. You know, I feel like I need to clarify that now that this happened. What happened to that guy? Shame. What else do I need to say? It's a legendary collaboration from a legendary producer. It's one of his best and biggest hits, and it's the standard that'll probably forever hold him back. Just like I'll never truly live up to the standards the worst music of the year set for me.
Hello everybody, worst music of the year here, and... Hello, sir. Can I interest you in? Oh God, another one. Look, I'm just here to sell you a simple product. So if you'll just sign here.
I have a taser.
Yeah, you better run. Hello, everyone. Where's Music of the Year here? Sorry, I was so rudely interrupted by that telemarketer.
That is an actual video I uploaded to YouTube 3 years ago. Here's a link. Go crazy.
Pigs try to get at you. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot. Park it like it's hot.
I like Rihanna. She's a relatively good performer, and I find she's capable of making some pretty amazing music when her producers decide to put in some actual effort that day. That being said, her career's been a disjointed mess from pretty much minute one. Yep, here's that Rihanna rant I was sitting on for so long. Glad to finally get this off my chest. Rihanna made her way onto the scene in 2005 with her smash hit, please don't kill me for this. The incredibly mediocre Pond de Replay. The buzz she got from this number 2 smash hit wore off pretty quickly as her attempts to coast off its success just got mediocre after a while. Shallow dance pop wasn't working for her anymore. She had to evolve her career somehow. She started by dabbling into the hypersexualized territory, making some of her worst hits ever. Seriously, I fucking hate this song. Goddamn. Luckily, it didn't take her too long to momentarily wander away from the half-baked dick metaphors and travel into the territory of the dark and edgy because, well, it was 2007. But by 2007, she'd really only stuck her toe in the water, producing arguably her most iconic song to date. And a year later, she kicked it up a notch, diving straight into the realm of disturbing and random nonsense, misleadingly actually producing probably the best hit of her career. From minute one, it all built up to this. Rihanna's first real step into the world of the dark and twisted was a song about... Actually, I have no fucking idea. As far as I can tell, she took a slightly unsettling word and added a conjugation to it that doesn't exist. I should probably look it up, but honestly, I don't want to. I feel like I'd ruin it. Actually, fuck it, let me Google it real quick. Oh. It's just the title of a movie. Yep. Ruined it. But anyways, yeah, the beat is fucking incredible. This is meticulously worked out, it's fine-tuned, it's controlled, it's polished, it just generally sounds incredible. It's dark and looming when it wants to be, it's loud and catchy when it wants to be, it's horrific when it wants to be. There's so much effort in this, every single note is in the right place, which really separates it from the rest of the mid to late 2000s edge ballads. On that note, it's actually great to hear like a real transitional song. I've actually seen so many alleged career transformations that only produced one song, and it was always some lazily slapped together, irritating, mildly dissonant sounding instrumental pieces the performing artist just screamed over with no tact or control. These songs exist for no other reason than to be controversial. I'm just really glad Rihanna didn't do that. This really feels like an evolution and not just some gimmick. It's such a strong, powerful single, with a massive bass line, some of the most creative uses of autotune I've ever seen, and some endlessly memorable backing vocals. Seriously, that shit is so catchy, it's almost infuriating. God, this was such a good step in the right direction. You know, refresh my memory real quick. What else did we get from this transitional period? Oh. Oh. Well, at least we got one good song out of it.
5555555555. All right, so I asked you guys about Stronger. Y'all seemed to liked it. What do you guys think about Gold Digger? Clearly the superior track.
Not at all. No. Uh-uh.
Really?
I think Slow Jams is better.
You know what? Fuck you guys.
Unbelievable. The nerve of some people. Now I ain't saying she a gold digger. But she ain't messing with no broke niggas. Honestly, yeah, I'm not all that into the serious side of Kanye. Don't get me wrong, he's still great. He's covered really touchy subjects like religion with incredible tact before. The dude can be genuinely dark, haunting, and intense when he wants to be, but, well, he's usually not very... Heard they do anything for a Klondike. Well, I'd do anything for a Blondike. ...consistent with his lyricism. That's why I prefer this Kanye, the masking his complaints with humor type Kanye. That way, when he says something like this... When he get on, he leave your ass for a white girl. It fits, and it's fucking hilarious. You know, when it's not directed to one person in front of a large audience at an award show, there's something so great about a Kanye rant. It all feels so genuine and energetic, like he's hopped up on something. It's four kids and I gotta take all they badass to show biz. Okay, get your kids, but then they got their friends. Taken at face value, these lyrics both sound really good and serve as a genius work of comedy. But of course, when you get to analyzing them, they're kinda generalized. 18 years, she got one of your kids, got you for 18 years. If you fucking with this girl, then you better be paid. You know why? Take too much to touch her. We want prenup, yeah. It's something that you need to have. And when she leave your ass, she gon' leave with half. I mean, no doubt this is a real problem Kanye used to face on the regular, being a rich, buff, black dude and all. But I feel like this really hits way too close to home with a bunch of people who should not be relating to this. The public at large nowadays is very willing to assume that any woman who dates a rich guy is some gold-digging whore. Take Kim Kardashian, for example. Remember in 2012 when Kanye started dating Kim? If you asked anyone back then, they'd probably just say, oh, she's just a gold-digger, she just wants his money, the relationship's gonna last like 4 months, tops. And here we are, 2016, they're still married and they have two kids. And I know, she's the exception, not the norm, but even statements like that are kind of frustrating. There's still a very clear, baseless assumption that people are constantly projecting onto celebrities' personal lives. This kind of assumption affects Kanye too, and he's kind of encouraging it here. This actually might have been kind of insufferable if not for the joyous instrumental. Next week is the fries, so stick
by side.
The strong bass, the synth tone, and this kind of swooping sound all serve as a constant reminder that it's just a fucking jokey fedora and cuck, stop rambling, turn the goddamn computer off and pick up some weights or something. Though this wouldn't be nearly as memorable if it weren't all built on top of Jamie Foxx's surprisingly good Ray Charles impression that runs throughout most of the song and never gets old. It gives the whole thing a bit of a throwback feel, which is nice. It probably would have been better if they just sampled the actual vocals from the original Ray Charles song, but I know that's not technically possible, so yeah, this is good enough. Yo, she gon' leave with half 18 years, 18 years. In conclusion, it's a catchy song with a touchy subject matter and it's handled with care. What else can you really ask from Kanye? I mean, most of his songs are only two of those things. Your titties, let them out, free at last. Thank God Almighty, they free at last.
Got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Chandon and I'm over best weed cause I got it going on.
Ah yes, Marshall Mathers, Eminem, Slim Shady, the man, the myth, and the legend. His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. There's vomit on his sweater already. Mom's spaghetti, he's nervous. I imagine pretty much every other pop-hating white teenager in your life has already told you why they love Eminem, so I'm not gonna go into too much detail here, but the dude has some serious talent. Everything about this song is iconic. Every single moment. I don't have to show them to you. You know them all. Over, plow, snap back to reality. Oh, there goes gravity. It's like a nice bowl of spaghetti. The beat is rich and slick, much like olive oil sauce. The lyrics are incredibly well settled and woven into perfection, kinda like the pasta itself. And it's all topped off with Eminem's strong, smooth flow that packs one hell of a punch, much like a fine marinara sauce and meatballs. Every single line is perfection. Like this one. What he wrote down, the whole crowd goes spaghetti. He opens his mouth, but spaghetti won't come out. And this one. He keeps on forgetting that mom's spaghetti's dope. And this one. As we move toward a new world order, a normal sweater is boring, but mom's spaghetti's close to post-mortem. And that chorus, fucking incredible. You better lose yourself, your mom's spaghetti, it's ready. You better never let it go. No rap song really gets me as hyped up as this one does. It's both incredibly dark and incredibly uplifting. I don't even know how he did that. And it seems like the public really caught on to this as well. It held Spaghetti at number one for a solid
12 weeks.
Throughout the entire holiday season of 2002, this was what was being played on the Spaghetti-O. This isn't even Eminem's best song. Getty is the thing, far from it. Stan Getty is actually like three times better. Really goes to show Getty just how great this guy is. This song also spaghetti a new standard for rap, being the first rap song to ever win a Spagrammy Award. It is a spagegendary song with a spagegacy that won't soon be forgotten. It set the spaghetti for all other rap song Gettys. It is the spagest, the spaghetter, the spabestest, the spaghettiest, the spaghetti, 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 spaghetti.
Got the rollie on my arm and I'm pouring Chandon and I'm over best weed cause I got it going on.
Now, I like Coldplay way more than most people, but even I can admit, from the beginning, these guys have always been kind of- You guys already know where I'm going with this. Roll it. Such a strange moment, isn't it, when some plain old alternative rock band releases one of the greatest songs of all time. How does something like this even happen? How does a band go from the flat, droning yellow to the suspenseful, lively, fucking flawless Viva La Vida? One must ask the four questions. What makes this Coldplay song different from all other Coldplay songs? In all other Coldplay songs, we hear lively guitars over drudging synths. And in this song, only the lively guitars. Sweep the streets I used to own. In all other Coldplay songs, the chorus snaps into place all at once. Things are right way up. All at my way. And in this song, it builds up naturally. In all other Coldplay songs, we listen to a narrative sewn together with vague, frustrating symbolism. I jumped across for you. Oh, what a thing to do. Cause you were all yellow. And in this song, we listen only to a narrative. That was when I ruled the world. In all other Coldplay songs, we struggle through Chris Martin's constant, elongated syllables. And in this song, we don't. Get it? It's because that was a reference to Passover, a Jewish tradition, and Chris Martin's wife divorced him after converting to Judaism. I mean, I tried, guys. Nah, but seriously, I fucking love this song. I know this is a terrible sentence, but this really is one of the defining songs of my childhood. There's such an unexplainable energy to this, it's like nothing I've ever heard before. It's the most glorious possible depiction of a fall from glory. Something about this not even remotely retro-sounding instrumental really takes me back to the medieval times. Such vivid imagery, all the details just kind of fill themselves in. It reminds me of a time when I was just some dumb kid and every song was a journey into a different world, even really bad songs. And after so many years, this is one of the only songs that still has the same effect on me. Fucking perfection. Alright. Strange to think I'm in the minority for saying that Hey Ya is several times more enjoyable than Miss Jackson. I mean, yeah, Miss Jackson is incredibly serious, controlled, gripping, and well-polished, but sometimes I just want to have fun, you know? Miss Jackson is a great rap song, but Hey Ya is something of its own. Between Andre 3000's distinguished vocals, the irregular time signature, some instruments that probably only exist in another dimension, and probably the only two-word chorus I've ever heard and enjoyed, this really is something special. You think you got it, oh, you think you got it, but got it, just don't get it till this. This beat is fascinatingly good. It's pretty much the only beat I've ever heard that switches up its own time signature in the middle of every bar. 4-4, 4-4, 4-4, 2-4, 4-4, 4-4. And not only that, but it works absolutely seamlessly. I mean, you can barely tell. If you ask the average person, they'd probably say they like the song because it's happy, catchy, and fun to dance to. Which is particularly odd, given that the lyrics are about a relationship that's failing miserably. And you don't even need to dig to find that out, it's all right on the surface. It really is a testament to the song's production. They made a beat so fun and captivating that it shuts out everyone's perception of everything else, even the rest of the song. I didn't even notice it till Ben of the Sage pointed it out that one time. We get together, but separate songs are better when there's feelings involved. If what they say is nothing is forever, then what makes us love the exception? So why, oh, are we so in denial when we know we're not happy here? The breakdown is also perfect for the record. All right, now fellas, yeah, now what's cooler? Something about the spontaneity of it all makes it seem less like a scripted segment and more like a genuine live performance. See? In any other song, that would have been horrendous, but here it is incredible and endlessly memeable. Literally, endlessly memeable. There's something so special about the song's energy. It's so open-ended, this song could pretty much do whatever and it never feel like it's out of place. Andre 3000 could literally start rambling about how the Holocaust never happened and I'd just be jamming along. I don't really have a way to close this off, so here's an unreleased Chris Rock skit that I found. Wow, if that isn't just the least funny thing you've ever seen. Before we get to number one, here's a few
honorable mentions.
I was actually gonna put this on the list until I realized it's kind of a friend zone anthem. Shame. This song is a god awful wreck, but oh my god, it's amazing. Something about T.I.'s cheesy side is so endearing. Mary J. Blige, born on January 11, 1971, is an American singer, songwriter, model, record producer, and actress. Starting her career as a background singer on Uptown Records in 1989, Blige released her first album, What's the 411, in 1990. It's kind of weird how people just assume that I like Usher by default. Let me be honest with you guys, I can't stand this guy. His falsetto was fucking grating. But this is actually pretty good. Mostly because of Lil Jon, though. And just to recap,
one.
saying she a bit sweaty. Knees weak, arms are heavy, there's vomit.
Couldn't believe what I...
All right, guys. Here it is. Number one.
They see me rolling, they hating, patrolling in...
All right, guys, bear with me. Right off the bat, this beat is absolutely perfect. It's energetic, it's suspenseful, it's powerful, and it is ridiculously catchy. And the chorus is unforgettable. The minute you hear this hook, it's already stuck in your head. As far as just the sound and style go, this is pop perfection. But don't let this bouncy production fool you. This song hits you hard with the social commentary, right out the gate. Immediately, right as it starts out, Chamillionaire is just sitting there, chilling with his girl, and his music turned up, playing some Xbox, when the cops start approaching him. Both the lyrics and the video pretty heavily imply that the cops are only checking up on him because he's black, even though he's not even breaking any laws.
But we packing something that we have for we'll have a player locked up in the maximum.
Okay, yes, he is.
Warrants in every city except Houston, but I still ain't losing.
Oh wow, and he's notorious too. Okay, this is basically a song about a criminal trying to escape the cops. Oh, except for the second guy, he's not breaking any laws. Except he is. He's speeding. Oh, and he's drunk driving too. Splendid. Well, I mean, at least this guy's not dealing weed. But he sure is smoking it. But none of that really matters anyways. I choose to interpret this song not as a commentary on racial discrimination, but more as a story about criminals trying to dodge the cops, as they both eventually end up failing. It's a story about how law enforcement always prevails in the end, not about any kind of systematic racism in the police department. Which I guess isn't really helped by the third verse.
Thinking they'll catch me in the wrong and keep trying, denying that it's racial profiling.
Okay, yeah, so this song's narrative is a horrendous mess. So I guess this raises the question. It may have the best beat of the decade, but can I really justify calling this song the best number one hit of the decade overall, even though the lyrics contradict themselves on every level? And the answer is... of course not.
It's just like the ocean under the moon. It's the same as the emotion that I...
Ah, see that? I pulled the old switcheroo on ya. I mean, come on, you didn't really think that was a typo, did ya? Yeah, Smooth by Santana featuring Rob Thomas. That's my real number one. I mean, really, guys, what else could it have been? This song is a legend. It is the king of kings. Don't get me wrong, though, Riding is still great. Just, there we go. Riding, the 10th best number one hit of the 2000s. See, that makes way more sense. I'm the Double Agent, and thank God I got that over with. Alright, what's next on the agenda?